Well, thank you, John. It's certainly a privilege and an honor to be able to be the speaker here and tell you a little old story, long ago and far away. So I appreciate your coming in this cold, cold day. I'm going to do this. My time on the island was 1971 as CO of a CB battalion on island commander. But in order to understand the island, we need to go back a little bit in time with some history. And then what I do is to project it on the other side of my personal experiences to a personal experience a year and a half ago when I did get back to the island and see what it is now, a Rip Van Winkle experience. So it's been an island that anybody who's there has memories of, hopefully good memories. Certainly it was a unique experience. My time there really started in 1971. And as I say, I was the battalion commander of a CB battalion selected to do the so-called pioneer work to develop a communication station runway from scratch on an island that somehow still was there, undeveloped except for a copra plantation that had been there for 200 years. It wasn't like the Pacific Islands. Somebody was always there. The Indian Ocean, not so. So in 1971, you know, we were assigned this rather unique role, and it was a Rhode Island type of adventure for not only our SeaBees 850 that I had, but also for the Construction Battalion Center, a tremendous job of coordination. All of the logistics came out of there. And so it's very much a Rhode Island story. But you got to remember, it was a Cold War. This was 71. It was the heart of the Cold War. And it wasn't our ocean. It was the Soviet ocean at that point in time. We had ships that were transiting, but they weren't making much in the way of port calls, and we didn't have any establishments along there that they could go into. So basically, when we went in, we were very much under the surveillance of the Soviets. They were running ships around all the time that we were working. Destroyers, such as you see here, this is a Soviet destroyer, as well as Soviet spy or surveillance ships. So we were very much aware it was a Cold War. In fact, we had a detachment in Vietnam, the Hot War, which was still going at the same time. So this was a different context of time than what it is today. Geopolitics change. But the Soviets, when they saw us moving in and started watching what we were doing, were very much concerned, because what they saw it as was getting able to strike at their underbelly from the south, which we didn't have before. We could transit, but we really didn't have a strong point to operate from. But we would with Diego Garcia. So the Soviets were concerned. Now, up until that time, it was considered the Forgotten Sea. I mean, that's what term of one of the books that described the Indian Ocean. But to us, the motivation was, it was a communications dead zone. In 1975, we had a squadron of ships, including a couple nuclear vessels that were transiting, and they found out they got in the middle of the Indian Ocean, they couldn't talk to anybody. It was a dead zone. So that was our official impetus in going out there, not really, at least publicly, saying we want to be able to hit the Soviet Union from the south. But Diego Garcia, of course, is in the midpoint of the Indian Ocean. And from here, you have, with an airfield, surveillance all the way around, and with nuclear submarines, as we have now, the ability to move any place we want to, in particular right up through the Straits of Majorca and up through the oil-rich areas. Why is this important? Well, we said communication station, but it also is tremendously important for the transits, the commercial shipping across here, container ships, oil ships. Some 70% of all of the oil in India and China have to come through here for, and more than that for Japan. Tremendously important as to who controls this sea route. So with our entry into it in 71, the whole geopolitical scene changed. India is still there, but they don't have the capability. China's there. They didn't and don't yet have the capability to really control it. So we operate as a stabilizing influence. Then, really to start with, in spite of what the Soviet view was, but even now. But it's a place that's not easy to get to. How did it start? Well, it started really, so far as we're concerned, Americans, with a 50-year agreement in 1966. The 50 years is up this year. And the agreement is being rediscussed, renegotiated. I can't get any information on it, but I'm sure there's a lot of talks going on because the geopolitics, both in Great Britain and in the United States, have changed tremendously. Interesting, I've got this side view of Operation Pop-Up, Polaris missile. This was a part of the deal. When the Americans said, basically, we'd like to have a base on Diego, the British says, yeah. And the Americans really said, and we want the plantation moved, which was there. And the Brits said, well, that's going to cost money because we just are about, this started in 1966. Mauritius was still a part of the United British Empire, okay? But they were going to get independence. And they got independence, really, in 68. But we were making this deal before that time. But there was money going to be involved. So we said, wait a minute, you guys, you Brits, you owe us $15 million for all of the research on the Polaris missile. You haven't been paying us. They said, ah, here's the deal. If you forgive us $15 million, we'll consider it a quid pro quo, and that will take care of our deal with Mauritius. That's why the Polaris missile is important. So in 1971, this was in April when I went on, and actually I should make it just a little bit of a post facto correction. The commanding officer of MCB-40, my predecessor, was already in the island. He'd taken advance party out. So when I came out, we had a change of command. And then I relieved him as the commanding officer and the island commander. There were no Brits there at the time. None, except for the plantation people who technically were British. But it was us going across. And this is as we approached the island. After some 5 days at sea on an LST coming from the Cocos Islands on the east side, we'd already spent 3 days by air trying to get the Cocos Islands, but that's the only way you could get out to this place, by LST. So this is the atoll. Now, this is a more recent picture. There were no ships in the lagoon when we first went in, and there certainly was no runway up in this upper part right here. So this is a much more recent picture that depicts what it was. This is probably about 2010. But it's a beautiful coral atoll, and it's considered a classic coral atoll, some 37 miles of continuous land from here to here, the longest of any in the world. But it has three small islets in the front here. And Bruce, I had a Marine with me, my advisor. So we set up the island defenses, but we started getting reports of lights on this little island out here. So I said to the gunny, I said, we're going to make an invasion, an armed landing anyhow, of this little island.
Some guidance, I suppose.
Yes, oh yeah, yeah. So we got our mic boats, which we had, and armed about a dozen SeaBees with the gunny sergeant, and we did landings all around here. I don't know what we would have done, well I know what we would have done if we met the Russians, but I didn't ask anybody. It was strictly on island, and I've never told anybody about this before. So anyhow, we found footprints, but nobody there. But the surveillance ships and the destroyers were circling us about 2 to 3 miles out all the time. And so it's wasn't unreasonable to me that we could get so few recon people on that island. So that's the Marine story. The first one in the Indian Ocean, the Marine, and to my knowledge, the first armed assault on Soviets who weren't there. Anyhow, the island belongs to the Queen, but also to the hammerhead sharks, which are prolific all over the lagoon. It were a concern when we worked in the water. But I've got to emphasize that, yeah, it's a British island. There are only about 50 Brits there now, an army, or Royal Marines, who provide sort of the police force, and a Royal Navy commander. That's sort of the British contingent. It's because of the island and its future, it's worthwhile to know where it came from. It's, as I said, an atoll island, and what we see today is this, but it started off with a volcanic island, much as you see in the Hawaiian Islands, which continued to sink, but the coral kept growth with that, and ultimately, this is now about 5,000 feet down. But in Inuitok and Bikini, they've gone that deep, and they find it about 5,000 feet. There is basalt volcanics. Originally, this whole concept was by Charles Darwin, who you know for the evolution of the species, but he's talked about how everything evolves, and this was one of his concepts. It's a wet island, about 102 inches of rainfall a year. I've been looking at the recent records, it's increasing. The climate is changing dramatically, even in the Indian, not even in, but in the Indian Ocean. In the last 10 years, the rainfall has averaged about 120 inches. It's getting wetter, and sea level is rising. But it's a tropical island, and while it's wet, we fortunately, there is a dry season, and we had most of our time was on the dry season to start our construction. But it's a beautiful island, beautiful coral sand beaches. The mystic banyan trees are found in the jungle, but it's still a beautiful island, particularly on the plantation side, which is now completely reserved as a environmental niche. There are no seagulls. These things look like seagulls when they're flying, but there are no seagulls on Diego Garcia. But there's coconut crab, which will go about 3 feet in span, and as some of our SeaBees tested out, they'll chop a broomstick right in two, as well as your fingers. So they are something not to fool around with. But the plantation people would eat them. But now they're back proliferating at the plantation because there's nobody to bother them. And the British have environmental control. They protect them. But the other thing that interests are the donkeys in the jungle. These are remnants of 200 years ago, the coconut plantation. These were imported as labor to replace slave labor back in 1834. And with mechanization, they were just turned loose in the jungle. They're still there today. We've got donkey gates to keep them from getting onto the runway, but they are happy in the jungle, but they're also very curious. But the reason for being for the island before we came was copra, just the meat of the coconut tree. And the French, back in the last part of the 1700s, first decided that, yeah, we can do something with that. And so the French got a concession. They owned the island at that time with Île-de-France, which then Napoleonic Wars took over, and it became Mauritius, and the territory became British, and the British took up the copra plantation. When we were out there, and still, the island is separated into two areas of responsibility or jurisdiction. Well, the Brits have jurisdiction, police-type jurisdiction over everything. This is a completely off-limits, the old plantation area. It's been reverted back to an environmental type of sort of reforestation, although with all of the 200 years of occupancy, there are a lot of trees that were not native to start with. But the U.S. side is all of this right here. This is one of our original maps, and you'll see French notations in all these. This is one of the first maps I had that we started annotating stuff on. Even in 71, the plantation's language was not English. It was French and French Creole. The French had the island first. The British took it over in the Napoleonic Wars. The flag changed. The culture, the people did not. So French Creole was the language of the plantation. I had Louisiana SeaBees Interestingly enough, they could converse with the plantation people in Creole. French Creole in Louisiana, archaic between the two, but they could still understand each other. Amazing. This is an interesting picture, 1819. This was still in the days of slavery. No donkeys in this picture. These are oil press mills, and the slaves were hitched up to these posts and round and round and round to press out the oil from the copra. 34, though, emancipation by the British, the donkeys came in. But the slaves then were technically became contract laborers, which officially is what they were in 1971 as they were moved out. Your contract's up. Now, this is a continuing big bone of contention. So when you look it up on the internet and you see Diego Garcia, you'll see a lot of very slanted views as to what the island is, what did we do to these people, etc. So I'm not going to talk to that, but it was a very unique one. But the thing this one is that you see a ship with the American flag. This is a sealing ship, an American brig from Boston. These people here are not visitors. They were shipwrecked off of a Dutch warship that was offshore, had been damaged in a storm, was sinking, but couldn't make it into the lagoon. This sealer happened to be in getting supplies, went off and offloaded 300 Dutchmen off this warship, including an admiral and the head of the Dutch East Indies Company. I mean, very dignitary. This is why the Dutch flag flies there too. But this American rescued him, 300 of them. But it took 2 months for some of these people to get back off the island to Mauritius to go on their way. So they're still walking around with their walking sticks, and meanwhile, you know, turtles are being taken over to cook for them and all kinds of good stuff. So it was an interesting event in which Americans were first involved in the island. When I was there, you know, this is Samson, the champion coconut picker and husker. This old gentleman here, Mr. Colorador Amador, he was the oldest man on the island, and he's the one that said, hey, he pointed out places on the island. He also told us, don't go swimming at night, there are sharks here. And this is a plantation's manager house, a church, and again, French Catholic church, but this is a normal abode of the plantation workers. But it was the end of the year in October. We'd spent 8 months with the plantation, and they were supposed to have been moved out in July. They did not. They were not, for a lot of reasons that were inefficient on the British side. But we tried to, we took care of them. We gave them medication. We sent our doctors over, our dentists over, and provided them food, really, up until October, when they sailed out on the last of the Copra sailing ships, you know, under sail. And I took this picture just in the last, I call it the last sail. And the last of the islanders went away on this one, on a bright, bright sunlit morning. Now, many flags flew. We took the flag down at the plantation and then put it up on the SeaBees side. And actually, it was a Union Jack then, but I gave the flag to the plantation manager. So I didn't have it. We had the British Royal Ensign, which we then flew. In the island command, we not only had most of the SeaBees, but we also had a beach group, the ACBs, for offloading over the beach, logistic support component, which would ultimately take care of all of the runway operations, a CHAP group, which was the stevedoring operation from ship to lighters, the communication unit. This is a transportable communication tactical unit, but it came by ship, not by air. In a medical unit, I had 6 doctors, dentists, anesthesiologists, everything, because we were completely isolated. You couldn't get anybody off if we had somebody hurt. And then they assigned me a support ship on station, an LST, until we got the runway done, which was about mid-deployment. So the ship could go any place that we wanted. They did go to Mauritius and pick up fruit and vegetables, which we were, by the embassy, State Department, ordered to do as a matter of, I don't know, official contributions to the Mauritian economy. But the fruit and vegetables were no good by the time they got back to our island. But we did it anyway. Anyhow, but everything came from an island to Diego Garcia. This is Davisville Pier. And this is what the ships would, of course, then anchor out in the lagoon. We had to lighter them ashore. And this is Admiral Pratt Beach. Admiral Pratt was the commander-in-chief of the Atlantic Force. He was our boss. It was all on the, even though Indian Ocean, it was all run out of the Atlantic side, not the Pacific side. It's since been shifted to the Pacific, but that, in those days, it was all Atlantic. So these are just lighter barges which would come up against these pontoon barges. These are the old so-called magic boxes of World War II, particularly Normandy, but even back to Anzio and everything, just big square, or actually rectangular box, steel boxes that floated, bolted together, but that was our offloading dock, causeway. Initially, of course, tents is all you had. In the first group, it was only about 30 people. The advance party started going ashore, putting up tents, and then progressed from there. Mess hall, recreation wasn't much, had a few fishing poles, and this is one of my warrant officers. Sunday afternoon, after we got the runway, you could get Sunday afternoon off and go fishing. And he's just caught a shark. Essential construction components. For us, water, you got lots of salt water, but you can't drink it and you can't make good quality concrete with it. Aggregate, where do you get this? I mean, this is big bulk weight stuff, not to be hauled from the United States. And cement, which wasn't on the island, but was a critical component. Water everywhere, nor any drop to drink. It's the old line, and that's true. The early exploratory people who went to the island, including a contractor, said there ain't no water on the island. So the way we're going to handle it is we're going to give you three of these old water distillation barges, which they did. And for the first month, they really worked. And then about 4 months in, they started going down. They weren't meant for long-term operation. And so in August, a guy came in, he said, you know, Captain, I just got this water. I said, where'd you get it? He said, the barges. And they tested it. He says, it tastes salty to me. Yeah, it was really salt water. All of the lines inside the barge had broken down and they'd crossed over. And that was the first one. The second one went down. And that's when I was really in trouble, because we had a half a tank of water in the storage tank and we weren't making any water. So, but I had enough knowledge to say, this is a wet island. There ain't no rivers, lakes on the island. It all sinks into the ground. Yeah, so the next day we got out our bulldozers and our digging equipment and started digging about 10 feet down to the water table and tested it. It's fresh. And I did some calculations and figured that there had to be 100 feet of water, which was proven to be the case. Fresh water under the widest part of the island. So this is what it looks like in cross-section. There's fresh water floating on heavier salt water. It's just a matter of density. The fresh water is light. This is heavy. It floats on top. You just put your shallow well down, and you've got yourself fresh water. It smelled of hydrogen sulfide, but spray it up in the air, that disappeared. And we drank it without chlorination to start with, and then we did some chlorination just to safety. But today, this is still the water supply for 3,000 people on the island. They got about 124 shallow wells now, all connected up through very sophisticated control system for salinity, water level, and so forth. So it's a very, very viable system. There's lots of water on the island. And at one point, they had over 6,000 people on the island, all drinking water out of here, for the most part. So this is a very interesting phenomenon on islands.
You don't collect any rain?
No, in fact, the Commodore suggested that we collect rainwater off the runway, but on second thought, wait a minute, with all the planes, you don't want to do that. It would provide you construction water, but not drinking water. On the plantation side, yes, that's what they did. They collected their drinking water, and some of the buildings had steel or metal roofs, and they funneled it down and connected it into big old barrels. And we tested their water, and it was good. So they were drinking good water, but that was their drinking water on the other side. So it could be done in a sophisticated way. Groundwater is safer from a lot of viewpoints, but and you can get a lot of it there. But on the plantation side, they had some shallow wells, but they weren't protected. They were just contaminated by all of their animals and everything, so their drinking water came from the roof. Cement came all the way again from Davisville, and these are 50 cubic feet rubberized type bags, and we then would have to pick it up and dump the cement out. Unfortunately, though, some of these bags were wetted and filled in wet weather in Davisville, and they came and they were just big old hunks of rock. So we're doing well on the runway, and the cement didn't come in from Davisville. We were running out. So I got the LST. I said, I gave my supply officer a whole bag full of money and asked the LST skipper to take a run to Mauritius and get every bag of cement we could. So we put a couple of dozen SeaBees on, and my supply officer with a bag of money to Mauritius, which is about 6 days away. But they scoured the whole island, and they manhandled bags of cement. I think there was 10,000 bags of cement they got, which kept us going until the next run came in. What was our assignments? Well, to build, and build a communications facility, number one, a town for about 1,000 people, number two, and an airfield, which would be at least one C-130 capable, and then a support base, starting dock facilities and so forth. But the first one was really the communications. That, as I said, it was a dead zone. And so basically we had the communications unit found the tallest coconut tree. I think this is about 80 feet high, and put a transmitter on there. And we had, I think it was almost two dozen specialists, communications specialists with this unit, and a lieutenant commander in charge. And they put a first message out. This is the second message. The first one, in six little vans nestled under coconut trees, six little jennies buzzing like bees, 22 men in CB greens, work 3 days on pork and beans, give to NAVCOM its lifelong dream, worldwide communication, smooth as cream. And they did it. They did it, and it was only less than a week after they first landed on the island. We put our first dozer down there to clear out a spot for them, and they were fabulous. And Zumwalt sent a personal message of congratulations, as well he should have. But then 2 years later, there was a permanent, we started a communications facility, permanent ones. 2 years later, then a permanent communication station was established to replace the tactical units, and this was their goodbye message. Despite the donkeys, despite the rains, M8 Act 2-4 no longer remains. We pack up our bags and do depart. Act 2-4 is off the air. So that was very momentous. But for the town, this is what we built, so-called SEA huts, or Southeast Asia huts. These are the kind that we build all over Southeast Asia. They're plywood, but all pre-dimensioned and so forth, so they can go up fast. We built probably a couple hundred of these guys right here, but we also built outhouses. And you didn't want to be at the bottom of the totem pole on the island, as somebody had to empty these things out every day. The fuel pier, we built a fuel pier and causeway out in half mile out into the lagoon. As I said, sharks are a problem. And we had the surveyors lining up this and doing the surveying out in advance of this in the water up to the waist. So we stationed CB shark shooters all along the causeway edge right there. Never had a problem, but it was a real concern. But the classic, of course, the bulldozers pushing down the coconut trees. And coconut trees are fun to push down, but they're a son of a gun to get rid of. And we had thousands and thousands of them. And we tried burning them, sort of the logical thing. They don't burn at all. They're very dense, and they also have a lot of water content. But they're so dense that we said, well, maybe we can put them on barges and dump them offshore. And they don't sink. I mean, they were just, and so we ended up, we just had to dig big trenches alongside the runway and buried them in there, where they're still there today. But they're windrowed in alongside, so they're not a problem. But it was a real concern. How do you get rid of a coconut tree? We had one casualty. One of these guys was pushing down a coconut tree, and somehow it got and sprang back and took out a chunk of skull right in his head. And he was evacuated to the Philippines. He survived. In fact, I corresponded with him about a month ago. He went, after recuperation, he went back to duty and spent 20 years retired. I was happy to hear that. I never heard that story until somebody told me, send him a book, which I did. But this guy, it was a real concern because he really lost a chunk of skull. The runway itself, what we built was made out of what they called soil cement, but it was a very rigidly compacted coral and cement and water. And it's very, very much the specifications, because all of the stuff that we did was to what they call B.I.O.T and specifications. It wasn't do anything you want. I mean, it had to hold up, and this was being prepared for C-130s. And it had a nice hard surface when we finished. It wasn't concrete, but it was pretty close to it. And but it was a very, very rigorous type of operation to get the leveling process, the compaction and everything, the specifications. And finally, this is it. I took this picture from that first C-130 that came in. And the pilot said, you want to see your island? I said, sure. So he flew us over, and we got a real first bird's eye view of what we did really looked like. 15 July, 3 days ahead of our schedule, we got this runway in.
How long was the runway?
3,000 feet. This is the first plane coming in, a C-130 coming in from Thailand, some 2,500 miles away. It's flown by a Lieutenant Colonel in the Air Force. He and his other fellows in Thailand were still flying sorties and runs over Vietnam, which is still very active at that time. So this was an alternate route. I asked him, he said, I'm not sure I prefer this or Vietnam, because he was the third plane that attempted to find the island. The first two reached the point of no return and turned back. They were used to flying to Vietnam, line of sight, coastlines, rivers, not celestial navigation, although technically they were supposed to be able to do that. But they were too rusty, so they turned back. And so it was a few days after our runway before we got that first plane in. So he was a very notable type. This is the plantation manager, Marcel Molinier. French name, old French family, British island, but his heritage is all French. This is Lieutenant Commander Rao. He was the OIC of my support unit, who was specialized for runways, administration, and maintenance, and so forth. And this is a young me. Well, let me go back. There is one other thing I'll point out. This reindeer up here is significant. The code name, because the place was classified in its early days, was Reindeer Station. And so that's what we still called it. And when I found out in the plantation, when they closed it up, the plantation manager gave me some coins. He said, here, you want these? I looked at one, there's a reindeer on it. And it was a Mauritian reindeer. And they named it appropriately, and I never found out if they did it deliberately or. Most of our SeaBees, when they first heard we were going to Reindeer Station, thought they were going up north. It may have been a intended subterfuge. So, I'll give you some epilogue here. We talked about the prepositioned ships. There were anywhere, when I was there a year and a half ago, I'd say I think there were about 16 out there then. There typically are 12 to 20 in the lagoon, all ready to go. And as I said, they're anchored, and not to buoys, they're hard bottom anchored. But they're loaded with 30-day provision for Marines, and several of these are for Army. But everything from tanks, ammunition, food supplies, everything, fuel, of course. So these guys are all ready to go on hour's notice. And they did when the Gulf War broke out. And so this is the status today of what it is there. Now, when I was out there, there were no planes stationed there. They are deployed in and out depending on the need. And in the heyday of the Gulf War, the bomber crews, this was filled up. The bomber crews, you know, slept in tents, and there were some over 2,000 to 3,000 of those as support people in bomber crews for rest. But this is what it is today, capable of really handling not only this as a runway, but more. Well, let me back. Well, I'll slip this one in, because Bob Hope was certainly a great guy, and he came on the first C-141 jet plane to land on the runway. By that time, it had been extended, I think, to about 4,500 or 5,000 feet. But he brought his whole Christmas troop out here. And of course, as I mentioned somebody, we were all guys. I mean, I wasn't here then. This was a year later. But it was still an all-man Navy, and all the SeaBees were all male. So, you know, you can bet that his Christmas entourage was welcomed. Interesting, he also brought his wife out, though. Maybe she said, I got to go along if you're going with all these girls. Probably that's more it. So they enjoyed a brief stay on the island. But they came back, Bob Hope came back about 15 years later, he and his wife. So they must have had fond memories. And they were put up in a suite, special VIP suite. Well, after they left, the captain and the British rep at that time said, we got to make something special out of this one. So they called it the honeymoon suite for Bob Hope and his wife. Well, there's a problem, though, because other people said, I'd like to use that. But the Brits had a law that anybody on the island cannot have a married companion on the island. Or now, I don't know how they say it, but you couldn't be married and living together on the island was at that time. So the Brit said, well, I'll tell you what we'll do. In the justice of peace, the Brit can marry, not the American captain, but the Brit can do the marriage ceremony. So he said, and now, in more recent times, you have females on the island. So after a month of unaccompanied tour, some of them have liaisons, and they say, yeah, we'd like to get married. So the Brit said, we'll marry you, but the next day, one of you have to leave the island. So it's still called the honeymoon suite. And if you go out and meet somebody, you can have your last night in the honeymoon suite if you get married. Anyhow, okay. As I said, the runway, you know, this is just a before and after. This is our original 3,000 feet. Now it's 12,000 feet long, but you still end up in the ocean. These are 1,000 feet overruns that we had at each end of it. And as a matter of fact, you know, environmentally, I was given very stern directions. Don't mess up the wetlands down at this end of the island, which we tried, we didn't. But that was all forgotten as the runway extended and carved itself all the way to the very end. I mentioned that the bomber crews and so forth, when they had to be billeted on the island, they were billeted in tents on this made land here. This is from dredging. And this area right here that you don't see up here basically is created land. However, the island is still very low-lying. The runway now, they say, is about 10 feet, I think, elevation. When we were there, ours was probably about 4 feet above what we called mean sea level. But it's a very, very low island. And the highest point was on the other side of the atoll, some 22 feet. And the dunes, the 22-foot dunes, when I went over there and looked at them, I saw white pumice way at the upper part of the dune. And what I found out later, this is from the eruption of Krakatoa in Indonesia in the 1876, I think it was. And the pumice is still there, indicating that, yes, you can get some pretty serious impact from a long way away on the island. And something like that would certainly inundate the runway, not to mention storms and storm surge.
Is the whole complex still sinking?
Yes, to some extent. It's sinking. My observations were the south end of the island is sinking because I saw old stands of coconut trees that were now dead. And just the stumps were still there in the water, and it's sort of a perpetual wetland. And of course, when they started growing, it wasn't. So the south end is sinking. When we made our excursions in the north end of the island on that little invasion, I saw elevated beach lines. So I think the north end is coming up and the south end is sinking. Communications a long, long way from the top of a coconut tree. You know, now they're very probably the most sophisticated communications setup in the world. A transmitter site way at the south end of the island, a big receiver site at the north end of the island, also a space geodetic station tracking all space debris in the world. Why? Well, it's the middle of the Indian Ocean. The air couldn't be better. So seeing things in the sky that's where you want to be. And so it's got a lot of communications operations there. Of course, most of them classified. Even when we had this guy going, you know, I talked to Lieutenant Commander Klein, who's the OIC, and I said, can I go in and see what you're doing inside? He said, no, Captain, you don't have a need to know. So I couldn't even go in and see what he was doing. And it's even more so now, of course. Come a long way from the tents to now air-conditioned barracks, running water, toilets inside, microwave. You know, it's first class. And bicycles to run around in on hard surface roads. We just had coral roads. Now, you don't have a lot of roads, but they're hard surface, so they can bicycle miles down one end and come back. And it's a primitive recreation, but if you like that kind of natural recreation, you'd like going out to Diego Garcia for another year. 2010, though, there was a monumental change in United States strategy, in which we said, yeah, we're going to say this is a nuclear support base. And they took the Emery Land, one of only two submarine tenders, and home ported it there from, I think it was Seattle, and they actually permanently home ported it there now. And so when I was there, you know, there were two submarines that were in here. This is not my picture, it's an older picture. But I saw the subs go in and out of the entrance now, cautiously. When they go in and out, there are two harbor tugs that are on both sides, very gingerly making sure they stay in the channel. They sure don't want one of these guys up in the rocks. And so, but they go in and out all the time. They come ashore for crew rest after their months-long deployments, or replenishment, repair. If it's a technical repair, the crew or the technicians are flown out from the United States to the island, and the sub stays here. They don't have to go all the way back home to the United States. And homemade submarine, home born and bred here in Rhode Island, also was out there. This is her just coming in. The islanders or the Ilhuai, this is the first return since they were taken off the island in 1971. There had been a prohibition against any of them coming back, which got great international argument, and if you look at the web, some very, very negative press on that. They still think they have should have a right to return. Now, about every year they've been allowed to return and pay respects to their ancestors and so forth, but they've never been allowed to reestablish themselves. But there's a movement of, the old timers are almost all dead now, but their children, grandchildren still have a very active movement of, we want a right to return. And the most recent one, just this past year, has been, maybe you should, the international community. But they don't want to return to those grass-covered huts. They want modern conveniences. They want to use our runway. And in response to, what do you want to do? Well, we think tourism would be a great thing for us. You've got the runway. Hey, they're not going to go out picking coconuts again. I mean, it's, you know, it's a cultural dilemma. You know, their culture is gone. It was a wonderful, wonderful romantic culture, which the old timers saw as, well, they said, living in paradise, and you forced it out of there. Well, it was what they knew. And I mean, they worked and all they knew was picking and taking care of coconuts, but it was an era that was going. I mean, it was no longer economically even viable if the company would have been allowed to stay and, yeah, you just keep doing your thing. Nah, it wasn't really, but they still, it's still a very strong movement. So this is a very, very active issue. The last word, well, this one I took a year and a half ago, and about 6 years ago or so, they not only observed before that, but found out that the shoreline where many of our barracks and our main barrack buildings are was eroding very, very rapidly. And so they started riprapping it. Millions of dollars involved in hauling this kind of rock. There's nothing like this on the island. And not only the rising sea level, which isn't just because it's rising, but it's warming. And several years ago, there was a big die-off of coral on the reefs. Well, the reef is what protects the island. And so you start losing that, it's a big concern. So a lot of the scientists are saying the island may not last forever. The question is the coral still growing? Is it growing fast enough to take care of the sea level change? And secondly, you know, you've got tsunamis, you've got earthquakes too. So 100 years from now, it may not be geopolitics, but it may be something else. Now, with regard to geopolitics, and these are work college gentlemen, China and India continue to accrete their military might. Yes, they do. They're not up to us by far, but they pull that center of gravity toward the Indian Ocean. This is a lifeline to them. And as long as it's not prohibited, they see U.S. as an honest broker. We sort of ensure freedom of the sea because we don't want a conflict there. But of course, India and China have still active combat activity along their borders. India has the biggest footprint in the Indian Ocean. And they've publicly said, hey, the Indian Ocean, that sounds like it ought to be ours. And we're going to claim that whole circle of influence. But they don't have the might to do it. But they're getting stronger and stronger. Someday, if there's a conflict, who will say who does it belong to?
So where's the British position?
The British have, that I know of, have no position. They've given no. Well, yes, after World War II, they started giving up the British Empire, India, Mauritius, ultimately, the Seychelles, all of the British.
So they've abdicated.
Yes, except it's still the Queen's Island, so they have about 50 Brits there, and saying, we're going to enforce British law. One of the things they tried to do early on, When I was there, I was fortunate. I didn't have a British representative with me. But a month after I left, a Brit rep commander in the Royal Navy came in and said, I'm in charge of the island, and I'll say what the rules are. And one of the first things I was told that he tried to do is say, now we're gonna drive on the proper side of the road. And after a few months of that, they decided the Americans were never going to adapt to that one. So they went back and they've acceded to their American way of driving. But yeah, when I went out there, I met with a British rep, and she said, I think I said, it's great to be back on our island. Very innocently, he said, our island? He said, it isn't our island, it's my island and the Queen's island. He let me know where I stood. Well, including the captain who was standing right alongside of me, the current captain of the Navy support activity. No, he made it known that it was the Queen's island and he was the Queen's representative. And for any kind of customs or anything, they're the ones that do the searching. I mean, it's not the Americans. It's all British customs in and out. And the rules, I brought back some beautiful coral, red, white, and blue coral, which is in the book. I looked at it and said, wow, red, white, and blue, that's the right colors. And I was going to pick up some more. And I had it in a box, and my counterpart says, you can't take that off the island. The British won't allow it. It's against the rules to take any coral off the island, he says. And I wouldn't even ask the British rep for permission to do it. He says, we don't want to make waves with the British. So that's kind of the British view. I don't know. It's not a military view per se at all, or geopolitical view. I don't think they have any more interest in geopolitics. Their oil comes, I think, mostly from the North Sea. It's not a big thing. And they don't care about China and India, I don't think, anymore, or even the Soviet Union. Now, the Soviet Union, you know, the current discussions have been largely about China and India as the big guys out there. But and I'm almost surprised the Soviet Union hasn't said, yeah, now you really can hit our underbody. Nobody talks about nuclear war anymore. But we've now got them covered all over. And nobody has said anything there. So the future, what's the future? Well, whose ocean will it be? Have we got the will, the cost? And I don't know where this is going in American politics. I would think there'd be some discussion. It's costing us like $55 million a year just to maintenance and administer the place, not to mention new construction. It's billions of dollars that have been put into it. Just the part that was authorized for the first 3 years for the SeaBees, which I analyzed out, was over $1 billion, just that first rudimentary part. Since then, it's tremendous. We've got a tremendous investment out there, but have we got the will? And the two issues now are Mauritian sovereignty. The Mauritians say, well, when you gave us independence, you separated out the British Indian Ocean Territory in the middle of the Indian Ocean because the Americans wanted to build a base there. Yep. The Iron Lady, Margaret Thatcher, was asked in a conference with the Mauritian authorities, you know, about getting the island back. She says, well, we'll give it back to you when there's no longer a military need for it. Ah, now they're throwing that back in the Brits' face, saying, she as much as acknowledged that there was a Mauritian interest in the island. Now, with the 50-year agreement, original agreement up, the Mauritians are saying, we should have a right to say what the Americans do in the island, what the British do in the island, what the future is, etc. It's an opening. And it's been, it's been pretty much understood by the Brits. And the fact that the Brits maybe have no more serious interest in it, and I don't know what their politics are, but they're not going to put any money in it. And I don't think they want any serious political problems. So that's a problem. But the right to return is the other problem. There's a very strong international collaborative. Now, the other thing that has happened is that about 5 years ago, the Brits established a ecological zone of no take. no take fishes, no take anything. It was an environmental, officially prescribed area. And so this now has been thrown out by a review at the international courts. And because they said, well, you're just trying to keep the Mauritians from getting back to their homeland and fishing in there. Ah, for us, though, it was a wonderful protection. Nobody could go in there around our island. It's a wonderful base. We got 1,000 miles of moat around it. The most secure foreign base, certainly, in the world. It's tough to get in there. You don't just float in there if you want to. Terrorists, I wouldn't worry about them. And thank you. Yes, Bruce.
Had many of your battalion already been deployed in combat in Vietnam?
Oh yeah. I'd already been to Vietnam. Our battalion had just come back from their deployment in Vietnam. These are the alternates that were still going on when we were out there, that the battalions were going to Vietnam. And then they went to places like this. But yeah, I'd say probably well over half, well, probably almost as three-fourths of, including my gunny sergeant, of course, had just been to Vietnam. And we had a detachment there in the Delta, of a 12-man detachment winning hearts and souls of the people. They were attacked twice by the Viet Cong, suffered 25% casualties. And that was when the powers that be said, we can't protect, no place is secure. And they weren't, the Viet Cong would come into this little village, and what these guys, these SeaBees were doing, they were, building roads, water supply systems. I mean, they were helping the people. Well, it was the hearts and minds, which, yeah, but the poor villager, as soon as it gets night, or they pull out, now what I do? If you were helping the Americans, you're in trouble. So yeah, no, it was a. We were, in fact, one of my doctors while we were there, got a very sad telegram. His brother had been killed in Vietnam, which I had delivered to him. Yeah, we knew there was war going on. Yeah. Yes.
Wow. Thank you.
What was going on just before the presence in 1966, or the interest started in 1966, at Diego Garcia? The reason I'm asking, I was on a ship in the Indian Ocean in 65, we had planned to go there, but we got diverted somewhere else. And I was just wondering why we were going.
Well, I tell you, it was, I think, the year after that, that we sent our first serious engineering recon party in. And these were guys who did drilling into the coral to find out where the hard coral was, and it turned out it's the outer reef, so that's why we had to take it from there. But there was a party of about, I think it's about 20, 24 people, experts, who went out to investigate the feasibility of an airfield. And that was just prior to the agreement, 66. So it was prelude to that to say, are we really serious about building something out there? We didn't have any authority or any money, but that could well have been, because they were taken in, by ship, smaller ship, and actually they sent up their little tent for, I think they were there for about a month. What they found out was that the Russians had been there just a few weeks before that, the plantation said, and they found Russian batteries and wine bottles and vodka bottles and everything right in this area that we were looking at, and the Russians had done the same thing, digging holes and everything. The Russians at that time probably knew more about the island than we do. Yes.
Yeah, appreciate your presentation today. As you and I had mentioned before, I've been down here a couple of times around the 1980 time frame, and I saw a lot of the donkeys on the other side because I went into the area with the British officer that was down there. But went down with a team from Subic Bay in the Philippines via Singapore with a human resource detachment to brief a lot of the U.S. sailors that were down there. And one of the things that was kind of off limits was swimming out in one of the lagoons because of the sharks that you mentioned.
Yeah.
And I would always finish the presentation with the sailors, because the sailors are going to do anything if you tell them not to. But this is a photograph taken from a helicopter, and there's a 26-foot motor whale boat on the surface, and underneath that was one of the sharks with his head and tail longer than 26-foot male whaleboat.
So yeah,
it kind of gets the idea that when they say you're not supposed to do something, maybe they're telling the right story.
Yeah, I've seen that picture, and in fact, they even named that. I don't remember what the name was, but they saw it subsequently a huge hammerhead.
Yeah.
And I went fishing once, you know, right off the reef. And I started catching, I think it was yellowfin tuna, and I got a couple, and then I pulled one in, and it went, the line went slack on me, and I got the head. And then I looked down, and here are all these hammerheads swarming around the boat. I mean, I wouldn't have wanted to fall in the water.
Got to get a bigger boat.
Oh, yeah, yes.
From your perspective, what would be the best type of agreement, extension of that lease that's up now?
Well, I hope there's some more college people here, because I would not be politically capable of answering that. You know, I know my opinion, but
you think it's going to happen?
Oh yes, yeah, I think so. No, we got too much investment, and you know, and it's going on, but you know what the conditions of our future relationships will be, particularly vis-a-vis, I'd say, Mauritius. You know. And maybe even the old islanders who may say, yeah, we want to set up camp over the other side of the island. I don't know. In the early days, you know, well, I better not say anything because I don't have any, I really not that well versed in the geopolitics of what's happening right now. And there's got to be a lot happening, though, both Brits on our side, yes.
The name Diego Garcia, was there any Spanish on the ship early on?
No. Yes. Let me just go back a little bit more in history. It's a Spanish name. And this was back in the 1500s. Excuse me, Portuguese. Back in the mid-1500s, there was a fleet of Portuguese ships that went there, and one of them, we believe, did find the island, but the Portuguese did nothing with it. But the island was supposedly named after Diego Garcia, who is the captain or the navigator on one of these ships, and that's where the name originated. So it's been there a long, long time, but which ship and it precisely when and it, did he land there? Nobody really knows. Yes?
The situation of Ilwa is interesting. I mean, the British just have a small office, I think at Commonwealth House, you know, about 6 or 8 staff that administer the island. But the recent thrust in that respect has been to make it a pristine ecological area.
Yes.
Now, the original thing, if you read in WikiLeaks, was that the British, in conjunction to some extent with the Americans, actually had a notice saying that if we make this area pristine, where you can only fish certain game fish, by the way, it's very limited, then the islanders won't want to come back because they'll have no form of nutrition or sustenance. That was the original intent. But it has since developed into an important sort of ecological project for England, and they've sent several research scientific teams out there to examine the area because it is unusually clean.
Yes.
I think that's one of the areas that are interested.
It is. To me, you know, when out there, I was both pleased and amazed at how it has reverted back to, well, a quasi-natural environmental niche. Yeah. And, yeah, it's...
Lucky you didn't get shot for taking the coral
away. Well, I've gotten verbally shot about it, yes. No, the environmental... I didn't show you the picture, but yes, we did put some pretty big holes in the reef. And environmentalists have taken shots at me.
The other thing is that the islanders were only given originally about £6,000 apiece in recompense for being forcibly moved off the island to Mauritius, where in fact the Mauritius, they have not been widely accepted at all, and they're kind of a beleaguered minority there.
Yeah,
they haven't been treated well.
They have not been treated well, and you know, certainly I do have a personal opinion on that because I have followed them, because I wanted to know what's happened to these people. And initially, when they first went off, I was told, and I think truthfully so, that well, we're going to let them go to these other, there are two islands farther north.
Yeah.
that had copra plantations, so they'll go to there. They'll still be able to do their copra work, et cetera, et cetera. And then after they left, I found out that, yeah, now they were going to close down those copra plantations too. This now was the big dilemma. Technically, the islanders belong to Seychelles or Mauritius, mostly Mauritius, so far as their citizenship is concerned. And they were contract workers. So at least the official American and British statement was, well, their contract's over, the plantation's closed, and they go back. Well, but they've only lived on an island. And what do you do when you go back? You live in a shanty town, and they were not given enough to really establish themselves. Yeah, and personally, I do feel strongly about that they were not treated right. And yeah. Yes, and far back?
Yeah, just a comment. In about 1977, I was in the squadron that was flying a loop out of the Philippines down to Diego and back again. And our primary purpose was to load as much San Miguel and Bombay as we could to keep the island well supplied. So we would land. No doubt,
you
turn off the Bombay so they come down. Turn off the heat so they can come down and be all nice and frosty. And we were very popular.
I can imagine.
Yeah, and then to top that off, I think about that time we had an intelligence officer, and she decided she wanted to go to Diego Garcia. So we took her down there, and she was put up in a dispensary because that's the only place you could put a woman. And then she decided one day she wanted to see the old gun mount. Still existed down at the lagoon. And so she came out, and I was supposed to show her how to get down there. And I did, except she decided she'd wear a bikini. Then just seeing what would happen, well, I had never seen so many Marines and so many bushes.
I tell you, I do have one, you know, John, I think is ready to go, but I have one more postscript. The island was never easy to find. You know, as I mentioned, there were two planes that turned back when they to try to get the first run to the runway. Well, there's another very notable event. You know, the first P-3s came to the island in about 75. And on one of those planes, and they were coming from Thailand also, over 2,500 feet of open water. No GPS, no satellites, and the clouds came in, no celestial navigation, strictly dead reckoning over 2,500 miles of water. There was a young ensign navigator who did the dead reckoning, and they were 120 miles out from the island before he finally picked up a real signal and said, I'm almost here. That ensign was John W. Kennedy. but John in his very humble way said, my stock as a rookie navigator went up a whole lot after that.
What was the Rhode Island connection? Was it through the Suez or the Panama?
You mean
for the ships?
Oh, for the ships? No, most of them. Well, I'd say about half of them came around the Cape of Good Hope. The other ones came across the Pacific on a circuitous route. You know. And we had some that had taken a stop at Australia on the way, carrying equipment. The first dozen ships were all MSTS, military, LSTs, et cetera, landing ship docks and so forth. Then the commercial liner came in, and of course they came from all over. But no, not through the, none through the Suez that I know. No, it was all open ocean all the way.
One last question?
Oh,
yeah. Yes.
What's the draft though? How much water is in the lagoon?
Uh-huh.
And secondly, if it ever became abandoned as a military, to make a great prison.
Well, first of all, initially the channel depth was about 33 feet. And even at that, you had coral heads to worry about. It's been dredged to about 50 feet now. So it can handle the Saratoga, which has at least bookwise a draft of about 37 feet, but there's also about a 4 or 5 foot tide, so you'd have to watch the tide. But the Missouri has a draft. I did a midshipman cruise on the Missouri, and I thought she took about 40 feet. I see now in the books it's a little bit less than that, but yeah, the turning basin, I think, is 50 feet has been the intended draft now.
I just wondered how you anchored in 5,000 feet of water.
No. The lagoon has depths down to about 100 feet, or a little bit over 100 feet. But I don't think they've dredged it that, I mean, dredging is a big deal. So I think they've got enough to have that 50 feet for an anchorage and turning basin. The south end of the lagoon is coral studded. In fact, I got hung up on coral going across. I thought I was going to be shipwrecked on Diego, one stormy day. But I'd say that. It will handle any ship that we have.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Sale. Nancy over there will be more than happy. Have it autographed.
Excellent
read, and he had a nice story about a young ensign.
Yeah, a more detailed story about John is there. What they did to him when he got to the island.
There you go.
But read the book to find out.
Yes.
But no, it was pretty bleak. In actuality, when he showed you those sea huts, the one on the left was the one that I had. Pretty there were definitely no women at the time, not to put too fine a point on it. Clothes were optional. You would come back, you'd just take your flight suit off, go out the back door, and you'd be on the beach. And you'd have your little...
What's the temperature range?
We were out there in our time frame. I was out there May through August, I guess, about that time frame.
Near the equator.
No, and it was 7 degrees south, so I mean it was a warm environment.
It's about.
But we were flying. I mean, we had
being evasive.
Yeah. two planes, and we were flying all the time. Going up to at that time, we were flying into Iran. Yeah.
Upper 80s is what the temperature usually was, with 80% humidity. And in the jungle, of course, confined well over 100.
Where was the R&R?
Well, that's another story. We didn't have any R&R.
You went away. You sent them away, didn't you, for an R&R to go away?
Not until the last part of the deployment.
Yeah.
And I had a little bit of problems with Thailand, which is where we were supposed to be able to go. And the embassy cut us back. I think I had 50 CBs at a time, the longest there, and the embassy came back 3 days before. We had them all lined up, cut it in half. There were 25 very unhappy CBs, but 25 very happy CBs who came back a week later.
Thailand, Cocos Island, and then Philippines. That was it.
Yeah. Sir, already, I'm from Indian Navy. So, is there any territorial zone and the contiguous zone association with the island there? Is there any public once you get to the agreement? So, the EZ and stuff, territorial waters, is it associated with the island or there is no?
No, there aren't any, to my knowledge, not in the Chagos in the Central Indian Ocean at all. The Cocos Islands, I think, has British contingent, but actually we landed at the Cocos Islands, and I don't think there are any natives there either. Although there,
wouldn't Great Britain do something with the EEZ? I think
so, yeah.
Because they would try and protect. I mean, but if you got that whole series of islands that go all the way up,
right
up to the center.
A lot of islands.
Yeah.
Yeah. Other than the Cocos Islands. The Cocos Islands are Australian, actually, but they were privately owned.
Can you smoke it?
Yep.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you very much. Books on sale. Thank you.